sergeant, both wearing black long-sleeved t-shirts with no insignia, fatigue pants, and very dark military spec sunglasses, escort a male prisoner to the cell. He's in his 20s and wears only a very brief hospital gown. From an elevated window, Control looks down at the theater space. Control smokes silently and watches a chaplain hesitantly approach center stage. The chaplain picks up a file folder and begins to study its contents. Suddenly, we hear the sound of a locking vault, as if the house doors are sealed. Christmas music blasts through the loudspeakers. Any questions, sir? Sir! Do you have any questions?
Holding up a severely redacted page.
Perhaps a few.
Yes, that information is not germane to the investigation.
It's what?
Not germane, sir.
I'm sorry, I can't really.
The sergeant flicks a switch on the cell. The music stops.
Thank you. I couldn't, you were saying.
The redacted information is not germane, obviously, sir.
Obviously, most of this file is not germane.
Yes, sir. Not germane. Classified.
Classified?
Yes, sir.
I can't even find the subject's name in here.
Yes, sir.
How can I...
Well, it's classified, sir.
I can't counsel a man unless I know his name. What's your rank, soldier?
Sir, our policy is...
You're going to tell me that your rank is classified too, aren't you?
No, sir. It's simply not germane. With all due respect, sir.
Well, with all due respect, I know a shave tail when I run up against one. Lighten up, kid. Come on, Lieutenant, you still reek of the academy.
As I was saying, our policy is to respect the anonymity of staff and other personnel, sir.
My policy is to know a man's name.
Yes, sir, and you'll find that the results of our policies speak for themselves.
Well, results? I'm just preparing poorly, I should point out, for a first session. Results are a long way off yet.
Understood, sir. By the way, your name is Jim.
My name's Jim.
Nigga Jim.
What did you choose?
We respect your anonymity as well, sir, and today your name is Jim.
I don't want to be Jim.
Deal with it, Jimbo.
Shall we move on, sir?
Jism Jim.
What's your name, soldier? Soldier, I ask you a question.
My apologies. The sergeant is new to the unit, sir. Now, if I may direct your attention to the file.
I ask that man, that sergeant, a question. I ask you a question.
Yes, sir. Have you examined the photographs?
The hell with the photographs. Take me to your commanding officer now. Now.
The director is occupied, sir.
What kind of a place are you running in?
There is no here, Jim.
Sir, the photos? Would you have a seat, sir? If you would sit down, sir, we can continue. Sit down! Please, sir.
I saw the photos.
Lieutenant opens the file and spreads a number of 8x10 photos across the table.
You might find it helpful, sir, if you examine them closely.
I examined them, I said.
To understand this case, perhaps you should...
Why don't you let me be the judge of how I should or should not do my job?
Without looking at the photos, the chaplain gathers them up and shoves them back into the folder.
I regret the circumstances, sir, but as you were told in your briefing, the process carries a certain... urgency.
I can't do this on a deadline. It doesn't work like that.
There's a war on, sir.
I know there's a war.
Yes, sir. If you would examine each of these photos carefully, you might find them to be germane to your assessment of the subject. Please, take another look, sir.
I don't need another look.
The sooner we're done, the sooner you can return home. See your family, loved ones, especially at this time of year. You're married, aren't you, sir?
I'm sure you know my situation quite well.
No offense meant, sir.
Dirty Santa party tonight, Jim. 1900. Don't make us miss it.
The chaplain blends the photos.
Sir?
Nothing. Sweltering here.
Yes, sir. It takes a while to become accustomed if you've just arrived from a milder climate.
Lieutenant.
Take your time, sir. We'll wait.
The lieutenant pushes a photo directly in front of the chaplain, who finally glances down at it.
Jesus Christ.
He's AWOL today, Jim.
What type of round did this?
M855? A saw, to be more specific. Are you familiar?
Yes, I know the weapon.
Outstanding, sir. This is the last one.
He did this?
Yes, sir, as the report states.
My God.
Big Daddy ain't here either, Jimbo.
I don't know what you want me to do.
Your briefing covered your assignment, sir.
Look, bottom line, I'm a chaplain, a counselor. I am not
a... Of course, sir. And in this case, the director is of the strong opinion that your background will be...
My background?
Yes, it's advantageous. Common circumstances. A basis for establishing rapport, sir.
A rapport? Look, I'm very open about my feelings regarding any further service to the military. Does your director know that?
Yes, the director is quite aware, sir.
Aware that I wash my hands of the likes of you.
Listen, we're the good guys, Jim. Come on.
Look, I'm done with any kind of double speak.
The director chose you for a reason, sir.
And is there a reason we're not underway?
Sir, no, sir. This way, sir. Sir, is there a problem?
When I arrived here, I had...
Sir?
You took my personal effects. I need some things
yes,
for my personal
sir.
Effects.
Yes, sir. I'll look into it after your first session.
Well, it would be good if I could actually...
This
have...
way, sir.
Lieutenant crosses to the cell.
As I said, there is some urgency, sir. Security reasons.
I still don't understand...
National security,
look,
sir.
Look, this is so far out of my pay grade. I have no experience...
Your experience is why the director firmly believes that you're our man.
I need my personal effects.
Please.
May I take this inside?
Certainly. Absolutely anything you need, sir.
Well, in that case,
absolutely anything within operational parameters.
The sergeant opens the cell door. We immediately hear Christmas music, which apparently has been playing inside the entire time.
The director believes in a heightened environment.
She flicks a switch on the side of the cell. Silence.
More to your liking, sir?
Yes. How do I address him?
There is no him. Jim.
The door closes.
Hello. I'm Captain. My name is Jim. I'm here to talk about your, well, whatever you might want to share about your situation or anything else.
I got worms.
I'm sorry?
Worms. That's what comes to mind. Worms.
All right.
I don't think it's all right. I got worms all over. He's under my skin, just a wiggling away. I feel him crawling in my gut, stealing what pitiful food they give me right out of my belly. When my belly's empty, they go and look for more. I feel him crawl up into my chest. He's in my lungs some days, choking me. No, it ain't all right. Not at all. So what's the deal with you?
I don't know that I have a deal.
Everybody's got a deal. Those people out there, they've been sending in a slew of fellers, one after the other. And each of them, he had him a whole deal going on, talking like he was the best thing since Dr. Pepper and rhubarb pie. Going on about how he'd do this and that, short of sending me to Dollywood with a white woman. So what's up with you? And don't get no ideas about Dollywood, because I wouldn't go anyway, white woman or otherwise. That was just one of them hypodermic situations.
Son, I'm a chaplain. I'm here to listen, that's all.
Like a reverend?
That's right, just like a reverend.
Nice. I've been asking for a drink of water for I don't know how long, and all I get is a reverend in a uniform. So, one more time, what's your deal?
I don't... You know, let's talk about your deal instead.
My deal is I got worms. I'm thirsty. I'm locked in a box with you and people staring at us. That's my deal. Huh. A reverend. What kind? Hard shell? Free will? Hey, you ain't a Methodist, are you?
No, son, I'm a Unitarian. Look, let's talk
He's
about
a what?
Let's just say that I can relate to a wide range of beliefs.
Utilitarian. Don't that beat all? I'd bet you as a Methodist, you hold your mouth all tight like you ain't taking a proper dump in a few days.
Look, I'm not...
When poop backs up, it colors a man's world.
Soldier.
When my granddaddy ate too much cheese...
Soldier! I'm not here to talk about poop. I'm here to talk about this.
The chaplain pulls a stack of photos from the folder.
You okay?
The chaplain pushes the photos back into the folder.
Fine. I'm fine. Goodness, this place is like an oven.
You reckon? So, we's talking about the weather, is that it?
Let's get you some water. It's hard to talk when we're parched. You're thirsty, yes?
Done said so.
The chaplain stands and raps on the plexiglass door.
May we please have some water? Please? We need some water?
He raps again, loudly.
I don't think you want to do that.
Stifling in here.
He pounds on the door.
Open the door! Now! I'll remind you that I'm an officer. For God's sake!
The chaplain slams his fist against the plexiglass.
Hey, that went good.
Yes, well, I'll get straightened out sure.
He's looking a mite peaked there, Reverend Jim.
I'm fine.
Just saying. I've seen frogs' bellies with more color.
Let's talk about you, shall we? I don't know what to say. When we take the break, I'll speak to someone in charge. I'll handle it.
Like I said, you might not want to do that.
It's simple decency. It's the right thing to do.
I suppose you's a guy who always does the right thing.
I try. Don't most people want to do the right thing?
Most people, they's out for theirself. They got an angle, always an angle. Always wanting something, dying for something.
Well, I hope to do better than that.
I reckon you do. See, I got you figured for a do-gooder, a guy who aims high.
I'll take that as a compliment.
Take it like this. You's the type who goes to whiz in the ocean and misses the water. That's what happens when you aim high.
So you got me figured out in these few minutes? I mean, you should have my job then.
Hey, I was just jawing, not judging. We ain't supposed to judge, see? Said so in the Bible last time I looked.
You live by the Bible then?
Sure, always. Don't you? I said, don't you?
Of course. I try my best.
Maybe instead of trying, you ought to just do it. No offense meant, Reverend Jim.
That's fine. Speak your mind, son. Tell me about...
What's on my mind is that it's better when it goes both ways. Me, I like to hear stories even more than I like to tell them. You know, the old back and forth.
Conversation.
That's what I meant. See, I ain't good at this business. I just ramble. But you's one of them fancy fellers that can pull $5 words right out of the air. Like that, Shakespeare guy. Hey, what was his deal anyway?
I don't know. But use any words you like.
I don't mean no disrespect, you being an officer and all, but I'd take it as a kindness if you didn't call me that.
Son?
You haven't done it again.
I'm sorry. I respect that. Let's start fresh. I'm Jim. What do I call you?
I don't like to be touched, neither. Kind of sets off the worms.
Forgot about them. Fair enough. What's your name?
Don't matter.
It does to me.
Still don't matter, because I can't say.
Of course you can.
Look, I ain't nobody. I ain't here. This place ain't here. Fact is, you ain't here. You just ain't figured it out yet.
Look, you're right in front of me. You have a story. You have a name. Tell me your name.
They said if I told you, they'd shoot somebody.
Shoot somebody? Who?
I ain't itching to find out.
A man deserves his name.
I deserve a drink of water, but that don't mean squat, does it?
A man deserves his name. A man deserves his name!
You better sit down, Reverend Jim. He's liable to come in here if you don't. I wouldn't push him.
Yeah, well, I can deal with him.
Ain't you I'm worried about. I ain't got all day, you know. That was a joke. Huh.
It's a good one.
Them fellas out there, they like their jokes. I mean, they send you in here, a utilitarian with the flop sweats. So funny, I forgot to laugh.
I'm not part of any joke.
A reverend. Come on. No offense, but I don't need no middleman. I was all right with God. He's been talking to me for years.
Wait a minute. God's been talking to you?
Sure.
How does... Suppose you tell me...
He whispered, leastwise at first. Out in the country where I was raised, it gets still at night. So still that a cricket sounds like a chainsaw. Shoot, the blood in your veins roars like a river in springtime. One night when I was just a small fry, I started to hear the Lord in that stillness. I'd hear him in the rustle of the wind, in the rain rattling on the shingles, a word here, two words there, a whisper that could snap an oak in two. And later I'd even feel him, like when a snowflake, a single one, would hit my cheek like a kiss, just to let me know he was there. So, you gonna ask me about that elephant in the outhouse? The whale in the bathtub? Godzilla in the pantry?
What?
What happened? The reason you's here. What's in that classified folder that's got you so bothered? The lowdown. The story I done told 1,000 times and gotta tell again just to get you out of my hair. You wanna hear that?
Look, I've been trying... Sure. If you'd like to talk about it.
If I'd like to talk about it. Criminy, you sure you ain't no head shrinker?
I'm just regular army like you.
Watching you fidget, I got my doubts.
You'd be surprised, soldier.
You might be too. Here's the deal. I seen him.
Who? I don't understand.
Shoot, there's only one him, Reverend. That day. The day it happened. Stuff in that folder, that was the day the Lord sent Jesus to me. Jesus appeared and talked to me full out. You should see the look on your face. You think I'm full of it.
I'm listening. That's all I can do.
I don't talk about this lightly. I thought you might understand. You're supposed to be a man of God and all. Ain't you seen him?
Literally? Of course not.
In that case, I don't want to talk no more.
A soldier. Look, long time ago when I was a kid, I thought I might have, but I was a kid, soldier. Kids look up into the clouds and see dragons and faces and, well, who knows what. In the end, though, it's just a vapor and a lot of imagination.
What's that supposed to mean?
I don't know if it means anything. Maybe imagination is its own gift. Maybe God is revealed within each of us. What do you think?
I think it means you don't believe me.
Well, I want to believe you, soldier. I truly do.
That might be the first honest thing I heard since I've been here. All right. You ready?
Yes.
Figure we headed out around 0530, aiming to hit first light when we got to our objective. Objective, that's army for where we's going.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Where we's going was a village about 40 clicks. Never get used to saying that. I gotta think of them like short miles. 40 clicks north of the zone. Weren't much to speak of, really. A few shacks, houses if you want to call them that. A couple days before, patrol took some fire around there. Maybe a few sniper rounds, hard to say. Anyway, the squad rode in 2 Humvees. Idea was to roll by in a cloud of dust and see if we drew any fire. See if there was any threat to the convoy that was about a half hour to our rear. Standard. Shooter was probably long gone, so we was going through the motions.
And what was your job?
Me personal? Don't say in them papers?
I'd rather have your version.
Sure. Turret gunner. Up top the Humvee. Manned a SAW M249. best seat in the house, they say.
Well, they usually don't have to ride up there.
You got that right. Me, I was all set to be a mechanic when I joined up. Learned a trade, like Granddaddy said, and I guess wrenching runs in my blood. I always figured I'd open up a garage when I got out of the service, call it Camaro City or something. You always want to be a reverend?
You were talking about the turret?
Yeah. The Army decided I could shoot too good, earned me a bunch of badges, and what do you know? They set me up top of Humvee. You ain't never fired a shot, have you, Reverend?
I have a few badges myself.
Get out of here. Which ones?
Let's get back to the...
The turret.
Yeah.
Yeah. Up there's the best place for spotting trouble and taking care of my squad. Best place for getting shot, too. But it was what it was. We made good time. Rolled up right on schedule, heading north by northeast, so the dawn broke bright and clear over the village. The light eased over the ridgeline, but the sun laid back, like it wanted another few minutes of shut-eye. Then it crawled out, burning red, red as I'd ever seen it. I thought of that story, the one where God turned that river to blood. You know it?
I know it.
In them days, the angel of death, he went door to door, like us sometimes.
Like your squad.
Anyway, the guys and me, we came up on this clump of houses. I smelled their cook fires. Sweet smoke, almost like the hickory back home. Made my stomach growl. And then this rooster, it commenced to crowing. Big old bird, perched on this wall, his tail about 6 feet long, seemed like. Feathers all a-glowing in that warm morning light. I said to myself, God is here. It was like he drew his finger across the sky, the land, that place. Do you know what I mean?
You tell it well, I can picture it.
That rooster crowed, and it crowed, and it crowed again. I heard a shot, close, loud, but I couldn't place it. Down in my Humvee, Sarge, he yelled, gun, gun, gun. Squad all deployed except for me. I stayed up top, swinging my saw this way and that way, looking for a target. That was the drill. The guys, they'd seek cover, advance, go house to house. I'm doing my bit, but I'm in this daze, you know? I can't find no target, nothing. But everybody else, they's already blasting away.
Then what?
Don't know. Nothing's right, see? The shots don't sound right. The voices don't sound right. Weird, far off, like they's behind a thick wall. A firefight's going on all around me, and I'm just sitting up there looking at the sky. Coming out of the sun, Jesus. Maybe he was the sun. I don't know. But he filled the sky, 100 feet tall, maybe 1,000. His hair red, his beard red, his robe red, all soaked in blood. He bled from his hands and his feet, from his side and his forehead. But he bled fire, not blood, and he stood before me aflame, but not burning. Do you know what I mean? Everybody kept shooting. The Lord filled the sky, but they kept on with their war, like he wasn't even there. It didn't make no sense.
Soldier, listen to me. What you're saying...
Maybe he didn't touch them, but he touched me.
Jesus?
Yes, sir.
Jesus Christ touched you.
He reached down out of the sky and he touched me, right here. And he whispered to me. I felt his warm... sweet breath in my ear. The war stilled. The world stilled. I lived in his voice and only his voice. And his voice said, protect my sheep.
Protect my sheep.
Yes. And I did. Reverend? Reverend Jim, you feel okay?
I'm fine.
Find my eye? You don't believe me, do you? Reverend?
Protect my sheep.
That's what he said. Look at me. Look at me, Reverend.
The chaplain rises, picks up his files, crosses to the door, and raps 3 times.
Reverend. Reverend.
The chaplain raps again.
Don't deny it, Reverend.
The chaplain pounds on the door.
You know it's so. It's the honest truth.
A buzzer sounds. The lieutenant calmly opens the door.
Sir, how may
I need someone in charge.
You know
now.
It's so.
Christmas music immediately fills the cell.
You don't look well, sir.
That man, he's, I don't know, this is ridiculous, absurd. I need to talk to your director.
Occupied, sir.
And my personal effects, I need my
sir, we're trying to locate...
It's important that I have my personal effects...
You know how things go on a long transit, sir. Things get misdirected, misplaced, they generally turn up, however.
Generally.
I need my bag. May I have some water?
Certainly. Is there anything else, sir?
Him. He needs...
There is no him.
The soldier, for God's sake, he needs water,
I'll
too.
I'll inform the director, sir.
Cheers, sir.
Would you like a twist of lemon with that? Sergeant, do we have any lemons?
Fresh out, sir.
A sprig of mint, perhaps.
Look, that man, the soldier, whatever you call him, I can't do anything.
Then why would you say that?
He's out of his mind, amongst other things.
Can you clarify?
Clarify? Didn't you hear what he told me? Talking with God, a bleeding Christ in the sky?
Downright biblical, wasn't it?
More like pathological. The man is insane.
Is that your diagnosis?
It's my opinion as a professional in the Army that he requires treatment.
Now, are you a doctor? Psychiatrist? You're at least a psychologist, aren't you?
I have an M.A. in human...
Are you shitting me?
I'm not... I looked into his eyes.
His eyes. Are you serious, Dr. Freud? Are you fucking serious?
They weren't right! His eyes, they just weren't right. I've seen it, I know. Look, you picked me, remember? So I'm not qualified. I'm in over my head. Get me out of here and find someone who can do whatever it is you need.
You'd like to bail, wouldn't you? Once a deserter, all...
Will you remind this that I'm an officer, regardless of the circumstances?
So you're still an officer. Is that the story now?
You know that I resigned my commission.
Canada, sir? Or in Ontario? His email originated from a town called Gananoqua.
Isn't that another country?
Currently, yes, sir.
I needed time to think. It's not illegal to cross the border.
An email? You're kidding me, right?
Email, sir. Rambling, incendiary, some might say it
was... Oh, why rehash such unpleasantness? Do you have the agreement?
Yes, sir.
You need some help, deserter?
Will you tell this man to...
Please, sir, let's review.
There's no excuse for that kind of behavior.
Yes, sir. You'll notice that the terms we discussed previously... May I have your attention, sir? The terms are listed here. Will you verify that everything is in order, sir?
You know, it doesn't matter what this piece of paper says. I don't know if I can help you. I'm trying to explain.
Yes, sir. Upon your satisfactory performance of the duties listed...
Are you listening at all?
Your record will be expunged. You will remain eligible for full benefits and pension, including, of course, disability.
You're bound to have people better qualified. If you just need intel, I'm sure in a place like this, you people have certain techniques.
I don't know what you mean, sir. And if I did,
I... Yes, yes, I know.
Trust me, sir. The director...
The trust you.
You have to trust somebody, sir. The director believes your skill set is unique. You can build a rapport with the, based on your theological training as well as your extensive fields and, personal
For
experience.
For God's sake, building rapport takes weeks, months, years, perhaps. Can you give me that kind of time frame?
As I said earlier, sir, we face a certain urgency.
But
I assure you, sir, the director's methods may seem unorthodox, but they prove to be unusually effective.
Unorthodox? What you're asking is insane. As insane as the man in the box! The agreement is contingent upon my performance, right? Fine. I won't perform. Tear it up. Take me back to the stockade, put me up for court-martial, see how far you get.
Full benefits. Medical for life, and an honorable discharge to take at your discretion. Then your pension. For life.
I'm already entitled to that.
Lieutenant, would you remind the chaplain that there's a war on?
Yes, sir. There's a war on, sir.
Think I don't know that? Read my file, you little shit.
A deserter isn't entitled to any benefits, I'm afraid, sir.
For the last time, I didn't desert.
You left active duty in a combat zone, sir.
I left your bullshit and your doublespeak and your goddamn...
It's a good deal, sir. All the director asks is that you do this job. One final job and a grateful country will be done with you. And a promotion, of course. With your years of service moving up to an 04 means a substantial increase in your retirement package.
How does that sound, Major? Beats indefinite detention, doesn't it?
We need an answer, sir. There is
the urgency, yes, I know.
There is a war on, sir.
So you say. Tell me exactly what you need. No jargon, no bullshit, just what?
You've seen the file, sir. 8 men dead, the balance of his squad. Evidence indicates a single shooter, but let's just say if others were involved, others from certain factions, the current political situation would be complicated considerably. You understand?
I understand that some people might be embarrassed.
Embarrassment is not an option, sir. Do you understand?
You're talking in...
We know what. We're relying on you to find the why.
You heard the story he told me?
We all have stories to tell, sir. At the heart of every fiction, one can find fact, engage, listen. Eventually, everyone slips up. I trust everything here is in order. Sir, do you understand?
Yes.
Can we possibly get back to work?
Any luck with my items?
The director is aware of your request.
I need my bag.
Yes, sir. Anything else, sir?
The detainee needs water.
We'll see to it shortly, sir.
It would help me do my job if you would do it now.
Of course, sir.
Hey, Jim, does a Unitarian believe in Jesus?
Get out of my way.
You know what I heard? I heard you don't believe in shit.
The door opens and we hear the loud Christmas music within. Finally, silence.
Hope you like Christmas.
They's just joshing with me. Most of them songs, they's all right. Jingle bells and candy canes and holly and stuff. It's the one about the snowman that gets me. I mean, think about it. He's got one day to get his business done before he melts, and all that traffic cop can do is hassle him. Like it's a crime to be made out of snow. Sad, man, really. What about you? You like Christmas?
In the army, doing what I do, it can be lonely.
My daddy, God bless him, he died around this time of year.
I'm sorry. That must have been very hard.
A lot harder for him. But every year, bless his heart, he'd haul in some scrawny old bull pine already half dead, and he'd make me decorate it while he sat there and drank himself stupid. Opening those boxes of balls and lights was like opening a grave full of the dust of dead memories that don't mean nothing to nobody. That was Christmas at my place. Good times.
You see if I can get him to stop doing that, playing the music.
It ain't nothing. Just another joke. Like I said, them fellas out there is right funny. You want to help me out, give me some of that water I asked you for. I seen you drinking your fill out there. I know they got plenty.
I told them. They're working on it.
There you go. Another joke.
I'll get it done, soldier, I promise.
That's all right. Honest. I like jokes. My granddaddy, the one on Mama's side, he was a big joke teller. What you call a comedian. I take after him.
It's not a joke. I'll get
I love me a joke. Really. A good one makes a dark day shine like new. There's this one he liked to tell, granddaddy, see. He was walking down the road and... Oh, wait. Shoot. This one's dirty.
Soldier, we don't have to. Go ahead.
Okay. So he was walking down the road and he came up on old John Gwynn. John Gwynn, see, he worked at the mines with Granddaddy. Old John was a-sitting on this pile of slag, just staring at nothing and looking like he didn't have a friend in the world. Granddaddy walked by, and old John looked up and he said, Pete, that's Granddaddy's name, Pete, I seen this old dog the other day, and he had a butthole the size of a half dollar.
That was some joke.
Granddaddy, he was some kind of man.
Kind of postmodern, I guess.
Oh, he's kidding, right?
Right.
Now you tell one.
I don't know any jokes.
Oh, come on. Don't have to be as funny as mine. I mean, a dog's butthole, that's comedy gold.
I don't feel very funny right now. And besides, we...
Granddaddy, he said life's nothing but a joke. We just take it too serious to see the punchline. I don't trust a man who ain't got a funny bone.
Look, I'll tell you one later.
Promise?
Of course.
You gotta promise, like you did about the water.
I promise, for heaven's sake.
I love jokes. Used to laugh all the time, me and the guys.
Your squad?
Yeah. There's this one fella, call him Fast Freddy. Funny as all get out. Old Freddy, he should have been on the TV. He was better than that cable guy. Leno, even. Every squad needs a Freddy, see? Helps everybody cut loose, blow off steam after patrol. Even during patrol sometimes. Hey, you know why we called him Fast Freddy? He could, you know, whack off and be done in like 15 seconds. We called him FF for short. We did at least until Sarge found this pocket pussy in Freddy's footlocker. You know what we called him after that?
No.
Pocket pussy. PP for short.
What happened to Freddy, soldier? What happened to Freddy?
I ain't ready to talk about that, and you ain't ready to hear it.
You know what's in this file, soldier?
My permanent record, I reckon.
That and photos. Photos of 8 dead men.
You act surprised. There's a war on, ain't there?
It's your squad. Your squad, soldier. 8 dead men, and you.
There you go, showing your whole card. What's your play, Reverend?
I'm not playing.
Everybody's playing. You ain't no different. Shoot, you was eyeing me like a starving man.
As I said, I'm a chaplain. I'm here to listen. To help.
Let's see. First guy they sent me said he was a lawyer. Came to help. Next one claimed to be a psychologist. Came to help. They was full of beans. And now they send me a preacher in a uniform. To help. Well, let me ask you, Reverend Jim. What can the likes of you do for me? It don't even matter if you's legit or not. The Lord talked to me. The Lord touched me. I don't need nobody to stand between me and God.
I respect your faith, soldier.
He pulls the photos from the file and places them in front of the prisoner. He doesn't look at them himself.
But God did not tell you to do this. God never tells anyone to do this.
Do what?
Those men were slaughtered.
How do you know? You won't even look at the pictures. Full of beans. I don't want to talk to you no more.
Look, I'm all you have, son.
I ain't your... You done it again.
Talk to me. Let me in. Help me to understand.
You can't understand. Look at you. Shaking like an old woman's teeny dog. You ain't been in it. You got no idea. I bet all you do is sit at a desk somewhere safe and listen to other people whine. You pretend to know God by reading a dusty old book and feeding folks the same reruns. Me, I ride in the turret. Nothing between me and some sniper but air. I'm the first to find trouble, and I'm the first to take care of it. I'm up there alone, but I do it. I take care of my guys.
Your guys. Your guys are dead, soldier.
You go to... I want you to leave.
Look around. I have nowhere to go, and neither do you.
You don't know nothing. Not about guys like me.
I was a guy like you. I know the stress. I know how hard it is to make sense of what happens out there.
No disrespect, Reverend, but that's bull.
And I know that at the end of the day, a good soldier, an honest soldier, has to own his actions. He can't put it off on someone else. He can't blame God. That's bull.
What God asks us to do ain't never easy. Not that last time, not the first time, neither.
First time? Let me get this straight. God told you to do things before.
Sure. I done told you about the whispers, but there came a time when he told me exactly what to do. That was when Daddy, he passed that Christmas.
Lord, son, you're gonna have to tell me.
I was fixing to, and you called me back again. Back then, we had what kind of passed for a farm. Mostly 40 acres of rocks and stumps. Daddy, bless his heart, he rode his tractor out to the far side of the property to get some sorry little pine to dress up, like he always did this time of year. Before long, I heard him a-hollering. The tractor, see, it had keeled over on this hillside. Found him half underneath, legs all mashed. He yelled and yelled about the rescue squad and the police and the army and the navy and the president. Told me to run to the house and call them all. And then God spoke to me. His voice came on a breeze, all gentle, like fingers in my hair. The Lord said, "Be still." Daddy hollered, "Get to the phone," over and over and over. And the Lord said again, quiet but real firm, "Be still." I sat with Daddy all day, all night, and all the next day. I prayed out loud so Daddy could hear and maybe join in. But he just yelled and screamed and cussed and threatened, God bless him. By the time night came around again, though, all he did was cry. He cried about my dead mama for a good long while, then he cried about his legs. Near the second morning, he cursed God for letting me be born. He didn't say nothing after that.
God told you to sit there and watch your father die.
Oh, no. The sitting part, that was me. Just seemed decent.
That was your father. Does God always tell you to do things like that?
Like what?
Jesus Christ, soldier. Violent things. Horrible things. God wouldn't just tell us to stand by and watch something terrible happen. You can get confused. It happens. But I need you to grasp something. God doesn't talk to us, soldier.
You need to, what's your word, grasp this. You don't hear God because you ain't listening, Reverend. But you ain't a reverend, are you? You ain't a soldier. Your uniform don't even fit.
I just want to understand what happened. I want to help you make sense of what happened. Now, we can do this together.
Together.
You and me, soldier, like a team.
Team my eye. You can't even get me a drink of water. Full of beans, like all them others. Shoot, you's the worst of the bunch.
All right, then. First things first. Guard!
What you trying to prove?
Just that I keep my promises. Guard! The water! Guard!
They's liable to get riled.
I don't care because I've had enough of this. Guard!
Just telling you the truth.
The buzzer sounds and the sergeant unbolts the door.
What the holy flipping fuck do you want?
I want the respect that's accorded an officer.
Hey, asshole.
You will not touch me. You will not lay a hand on me or this soldier. Do you understand? Do you understand, sergeant?
Sergeant.
Sir, yes, sir.
I will be treated with respect.
Sir, how can we...
I'm not talking to you, Shavetail. That man will be treated with respect. My duty is to him.
There is no...
To him, this country, and God. And as far as this country and God are concerned, he is due a drink of water.
a lousy drink of water. In this country...
Which country is that?
In my country, a man is still owed a drink of water.
Is that the truth, Lieutenant?
Of course, sir. I apologize for any oversight. The director authorized these rations personally.
Let's catch their Billy Blair.
Thank you, Lieutenant. And the other matter?
Any minute now, sir.
You've been saying that. What on earth does it take to locate...
I'll notify you immediately when we locate it, sir. We do have a time factor.
Tick-tock, Jim Marino.
This place is a joke. How do you people expect me to get any inroads with
Joe? I got one for you.
Step aside.
Ask me, what's the key to comedy?
Tick-tock, remember? You're wasting my time.
Come on, ask me.
Get out of my way.
Ask me!
What is the key to...
Timing!
The war. Sir, please.
What, you don't like Buddy Hackett?
The door closes. Meanwhile, the lieutenant puts a case of water on the rolling table, which she pushes downstage. She hands out bottles to members of the audience.
I told you they was jokers.
Enjoy, soldier.
You sure?
Of course.
Take it easy. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Not all at once.
Oh, that was sweet. Hey, I couldn't hear nothing, but you looked like some kind of badass out there. Kind of hardcore for a chaplain.
I do what I need to do. Now, let's talk.
Right, so you can accuse me of killing my daddy? One bottle of water don't let you do that. I didn't do nothing to Daddy, bless his heart. Tracker did.
Okay. Talk to me about your squad, then. Are you going to blame that on the tracker? Tell me what you meant by protect my sheep.
Ain't what I meant, it's what God meant.
All right, then. What do you think God meant?
Lieutenant hands out buckets to the audience members who took the water.
The Lord means what he means. This conversation business, it goes both ways. Like I said before, maybe I don't want to jaw the whole time. Maybe I want to know where you's coming from.
I have a job to do, soldier, and I don't have much time.
That's the point. I don't know if you's doing the Lord's job or their job. I mean, I look at you and you's all nervous Nelly and stuff. You got something going on there, Reverend Jim.
I'm your chaplain. No matter what else is going on, I have a duty to you, too.
Uh-huh. Thought so. Always an angle. Want to tell me about it? I'm waiting. Like I said, I ain't got all day.
Soldier?
That last part was still a joke.
Those people out there need help. Information. If you talk to me, perhaps everyone can get what's needed. Fair? Now, go back to the day. Tell me about your squad. What were they like? You told me about friends. What about the others? Come on, soldier. Anything like that.
I'd rather know about the fancy pants officer I'm spilling my guts to.
My story doesn't matter, soldier.
Right. More secrets.
Not secrets. Boundaries. I respect yours, you should respect mine.
Boundaries, my hind end. Boundaries is why we's here.
That doesn't make any sense.
It don't? The world, the way I see it, it's balanced. Perfect. Then you people, you go and try to carve it up, draw lines on maps. But for guys like me, it don't matter what side of the line we's on. We got the same buzzards looping over folks who's the same kind of dead. But we go on and on, fighting over your boundaries that nobody can even see. It's hot in here.
I know, all these lights.
No. I don't feel good.
What's wrong?
You lying snake!
Prisoner gagged and vomits.
Good Lord.
Medic! Stands, kicking over the chair in the process. He crashes against the plexiglass and continues to retch and heave.
Medic! Medic! Easy. Take it easy. I'll get help. We'll get a medic in here.
You don't touch me! You poisoned me!
No, I wouldn't do that! Medic!
Ain't that some kind of joke? He's the best comedian of them all.
It's them! They must... No.
You get away from me, you hear?
You sons of bitches, how can you do this? You gave him a fucking medic! He's already dehydrated, for God's sake, he needs attention! Now! Look at me.
You bastards, look at me!
Nice going, Jim.
I had no idea. I'm so sorry.
I've never been so sick in my life. What did I do to you? I listened to God, that's all. That's all! You get back! Don't you come over here!
Listen to me, please.
Is that a crime? To talk to God?
No. It's hard to believe, soldier. I admit that. It's hard to believe. Anything in this war, it's this place, but if you talk, I promise that I'll listen.
You hate me. You and all the rest. Why would you listen to the likes of me?
Because maybe if I listen long enough, if I can open the cynical heart of mine, maybe I will believe you. Will you give me that chance?
Really?
Yes.
You go to hell.
That seems like a real possibility for both of us, and you know that I'm being straight with you.
Look at that. You finally told the truth.
The buzzer sounds. The sergeant throws open the door.
Out, asshole. We've got to clean up your mess.
How can you do that? How can you treat a man like that?
Stand down.
I will not stand down! I'll have you up on charges, all of you. This isn't done. It doesn't happen here.
Told you, there is no here. It's like you're a real delicate flower, Jim.
I should remind you, sir, that the window is closing.
What?
The window of opportunity for you to fulfill our agreement, for you to enjoy the benefits.
I don't... benefits. What?
Will he be able to continue?
Yes, sir. May I help you up?
We don't do this. We aren't like this.
Of course not, sir. Please, inside the cell, the prisoner makes eye contact with the sergeant, who seems startled for a moment.
No.
The sergeant hesitates, then rips away the prisoner's soiled hospital gown. From outside the cell, we watch the struggle take place in silence.
What's he doing?
Just necessary cleanup, sir. It's quite routine.
Are you all out of your minds?
The sergeant begins to remove all furniture from the cell. The prisoner, naked, huddles in a corner.
Playing psychiatrist again, aren't we?
You can't just leave him like that!
Don't like it? You should have stayed in Canada, Jim.
Shall we get on with this?
If you please, sir.
I said you can't leave him like that.
Fresh clothes are forthcoming shortly.
Come on, get inside. You know Santa's on his way.
God help you. God help all of you.
I said inside.
Please, sir.
Truth be told, Sergeant, don't you have something for the captain?
Oh, yes, I do. Yes, sir. Right here. You've been asking for this, huh, Jim?
He produces a small prescription bottle from his pocket and rattles the pills inside.
What do they call it? Attaboy or something?
Ativan. For anxiety, addictive without proper supervision.
Hey, thanks. Says so right here. You want some, Jim? I'm asking because, well, I mean, you don't look so hot. Jim? What do you say, Jimbo? Jimmy? Jimmy Jam? Jim of the...
Thank you, Sergeant. Thank you, Sergeant. As promised, I apologize for the delay. Please enjoy them with the director's compliments.
Yeah, that delay. Sorry. Anyway, here you go.
He opens the bottle and pours its contents onto the floor.
Help yourself. With Santa's compliments.
The chaplain stares at the floor, then finally walks into the cell, the pills crunching underfoot.
You stay back.
I just tried to...
Get back, you hear? Don't look at me.
Still any nausea?
Some. Past, mostly.
Good. Did
have much to purge. I should still put you on an IV. You lost a lot of fluid.
Yeah, I'm as dry as my grandma's turkey. You took a lick out there. You okay?
Yeah.
How is it you know that stuff?
What stuff?
That doctor stuff. What was that word? What you said they used on me?
Emetic. It induces vomiting.
They learn you that in preacher school? Another boundary, huh? Another invisible line to fight over. That's all right.
I was a medic, okay? Long time ago.
Medic? Huh. Ain't that some kind of thing?
Some kind, yeah.
He removes his jacket and tosses it toward the prisoner.
Cut yourself up if you want.
You'll be out of uniform.
So? It's not good. It doesn't fit anyway. Take the damn jacket.
Thanks. Medic, huh? Shoot.
Soldier, I need to ask you something. I wasn't intending to look, but I saw those marks on your legs.
Ain't nothing.
Soldier?
Ain't nothing.
Did they do that to you out there? Those people out there? Who did something?
Don't you call me that!
I'm sorry. You know it's not going to stop with this. They're operating beyond any code of authority. If we're going to get you out of here... Is there anyone waiting for you, soldier, at home? Anywhere?
Granddaddy and Grandma, they passed. God bless them.
I'm sorry. Girlfriend?
No, I ain't no good at that.
Oh, come on.
Bashful, I reckon. You hitched?
No.
I get it.
You get what?
Utilitarians can't go with women and stuff. Like, you know, them, like them catheters.
No. Not like that. I'm just not married. Not now.
What?
War changes things, soldier.
I reckon it does.
Tell me about those marks.
When you as a medic, were you in it? I mean, you know.
The shit? Yeah. I was in it.
So you know what it's like?
Yeah.
Reverend, I've seen awful things. Terrible things. Things that Satan himself don't know. Things Satan couldn't think of, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Tell me what it was like for you.
Soldier, it's not about...
Tell me what it was like, soldier to soldier. You tell me and I'll find a way to tell you.
All right. I want to say it was idealism. Something about a new, better world, but it was a judge. The army or jail.
Jail? What was it you done?
Nothing. I broke the law. Growing up, it was rough. When I was 17, I hit back. End of story. And the world caught fire before I was out of basic. I wasn't about to die from anything or anybody. I walked up to my sergeant and I told him that I was a conscientious objector.
You didn't want to fight?
Not for anyone else, not then.
Now?
For the right thing, maybe. Anyway, long story short, they said they'd do me a favor and let me be a non-combatant. Train me as a medic and ship me out to the hot zone. It was that or Lebanon.
So you was under fire?
Pacifists don't live long over there. With all that lead flying, I got myself certified on every weapon they'd let me touch. I know a thing or two about your saw. What it can do to me.
A saw is your friend. An awful, awful friend with a temper.
Tell me about that temper.
It's just like, I don't know, when you squeeze that trigger and cut loose on it, you feel the gun get mad, then madder, then crazy mad, out of its head, and you're out of your head too, right along with it. All I wanted to do was the right thing, you know?
My job was to keep my guys safe. Sounds easy. Never was, though.
No, never.
But you done good, right? Saved people, I bet.
Maybe.
You did, for sure. Had to. Tell me. Tell me about what you did.
I don't talk about that.
I got to know. I got to know that you're the one to talk to. The one that understands.
My story's not important.
Right now it is.
I lay there with an exit wound as big as my fist. Extreme blood loss, probably from a renal artery. He was screaming. And I'm probing my hand inside of him, but there's really nothing to plant. Suddenly he's quiet. I figure that's it. He's gone. Nothing gone.
Then what?
Nothing. That's all.
Don't take this the wrong way, Reverend, but you ain't a good liar. Then what? Reverend?
He looked at me. Pale green eyes, like gemstones, they locked on me, and this man said so calmly it terrified me, "What's it like?" His eyes froze me. Tell me what it's like, he said. I don't understand.
Well, what'd you say?
Nothing. I didn't understand either. I said nothing. His eyes dulled and he was gone. Jesus, I shouldn't have let you on my head, kid.
I don't understand a lot neither, but when God, he speaks to me, I get it. Maybe not before, maybe not even after, but in that moment, me and him, like that. I get it.
You and God, like that. Maybe that's what I was looking for when I went to seminary. When I ministered to soldiers, kids too young to drink but old enough to kill. Maybe giving them some comfort, maybe helping them make sense of the shrapnel in their souls. If I did that, then maybe I'd find the answer too. I never did. God and I, it's not as clear for me as it is for you.
Funny how God works. Work for this, I reckon he might not have talked to me in the first place. See these holes? I think that's where the worms got in. And it was the worms that led me to the Lord.
You need to tell me. Let it go, sir.
It's just, when I think of this, I get sad. Real sad, like a chestnut burr under my ribs. Daddy, God bless him, he was bad to drink. And sad. Sad all the time, I know him. Not mopey, not weepy, more like something turned all hard inside him. It was my fault.
No, you can't say that. Now, a child might think so, but the reason a person is depressed, sad, those are very complicated. It wasn't about...
Ain't that complicated at all. Daddy, he told me flat out. He told me that Mama, a few months after she had me, he said the darkness came on her something fierce. He found her one day in this shed out back of the house. Said she hung herself with an extension cord. I weren't 6 months old yet. Daddy said it was because of me. She was fine before, bright as Easter morning, the way he put it. Then I come along.
No. You didn't cause that. She was clinically depressed. Had to be. No one was to blame, least of all you.
I know what he told me.
That was abuse. Now, please understand that.
When I was a wee thing, I'd wake up in the middle of the night, and there Daddy would be, bless his heart, right by my bed, looking down at me. I'd see his cigarette glowing red in the dark. Look there, it's the moon, he'd say. He'd move it around, up, down, and I used to watch it and laugh. I liked that. It was like, you know, our special joke. Then one night I woke up and seen him, like always. Look at the moon, he said, and I followed it with my eyes, ready to laugh. he pulled down the covers and told me sometimes the moon bites you, and then he put his cigarette on my leg. The moon bit me a lot after that. And those bites let in the worms. And they crawled up my legs and into my arms and my heart and my eyes and my brain, crawling, itching every minute, every day.
My God.
Poor Daddy. Bless his heart.
How can you say that? Bless his heart after what he did?
Just being polite, Reverend. Geez, where was you raised?
How long did that go on?
One way or another until the day he died.
Did you ever tell anyone?
Just God.
You prayed?
Yeah. At first, you know, the way kids pray, some little rhyme my grandma learned me about Jesus loving the little children. I'd say it every night, kneeling beside the bed. Every morning, I'd wake up with bites on my legs and Daddy's breath on my face. So after a while, I made up my own prayer instead. I asked Jesus why, if he loved all those other children, he didn't love me. Because if he loved me, I wouldn't be afraid to sleep. I wouldn't have scabs on my legs and worms under my skin. You think I'm full of beans, don't you?
No.
I said my prayer, and then the Lord, he whispered to me. He said that he was the Father who had never hurt me. He said it a lot. He said he wanted to be real clear on that. That was the first message. Later, he told me other things.
What other things?
That I was his special servant here on earth, and I would do something wonderful. And that after I did, he would take me up in a spaceship to be with him forever.
All right.
All right, what?
Nothing. It's just, it wouldn't be hard for an abused child to imagine a benevolent father figure. One that told him that he was loved, one that told him he was special.
You think I made it up? After all this, you think I'm full of it?
No. I heard that too in my head. The way I wanted it to be, the way I wanted my old man to be, but it was in my head, so that's all.
I heard the voice of God. He talks to me. He talks to you. He tells you to do the right thing. I know he does. Tell me I'm wrong. Tell me you've never been moved by God. You was lying to yourself, Chaplain.
Protect my sheep. Was that the right thing?
You think I'm crazy? Well, I'll tell you what. I think you look like you need one of those pills they dropped out there.
What?
Whatever you got going on, it's got a hold of you real fierce. Got its claws deep in your heart where the worms live. No disrespect, Reverend. There's a whole lot of crazy going on in this box. You sort that out, maybe we'll talk again.
Watching your father die was not God's work. What happened to your squad, that wasn't God's work.
Be still, Reverend Jim. Be still, and you'll hear too.
No.
Be still. You know the truth.
The buzzer sounds. The sergeant and lieutenant charge into the cell.
Hey, shithead, who said you could cover up?
He snatches the chaplain's jacket from the prisoner, then kicks him.
Oh! I didn't say you could fucking cover up!
Don't do that!
Do what? This?
Another kick.
You can't do that! He's sick! He's hurt!
The sergeant tosses the jacket at the chaplain.
You're out of uniform, asswipe.
To hell with your goddamn uniform.
Please, sir, this way.
Let me do my job, Lieutenant.
Put on that uniform and get the hell out of here. You're fired, fuckface.
Sergeant again kicks the prisoner who falls to the side.
You son of a bitch, leave him alone!
We told you there is no him!
Sir, please, we need to reevaluate our strategy. Obviously, you can't...
The lieutenant said you're fired.
Don't touch that man again.
This way, sir. Please, allow the professionals to take over.
Or what? Or what?
You'll see.
Get the fuck out of here. I'll knock your yellow ass back to Canada.
Hang on, soldier.
Move! You never should have come back here.
When the sergeant stops to secure the door, the chaplain turns, cocks his hand, and drives it under the sergeant's diaphragm.
I'll never concede my country to you.
Sir?
Sergeant, my ass. Went down like some limp dick contractor.
Sir, stand down! Lieutenant holsters his sidearm and points it at the chaplain.
You stand down, kid.
Sir, I am prepared.
I said you stand down.
Goddamn cocksucker.
Yeah, that's right. Get up.
Sir, I will shoot you.
I'll be with you in a minute.
The chaplain smashes his palm into the sergeant's face. The sergeant collapses again, his nose spurting blood beneath his hand. Get on your knees and put your hands on your head.
Oh, fuck.
I don't think so.
I will shoot you, sir.
I doubt it.
Sir, this is your last warning.
The army's pointed a gun at my head before, so pardon me, Lieutenant, if I'm not exactly impressed.
Fuck me.
Did they teach you the first rule of modern urban warfare, Shaved Tail?
Sir,
demoralize the enemy. Shoot their medic. The army shipped me out with a fucking target on my helmet. After that, you think, little shit, you can do anything to impress me? You ever pull the trigger on someone, kid? You got it or you don't. You ain't got it.
Can't we all just get along?
You're not going to shoot me because you need me. You need me to get something from that man over there. The one that you're so intent on brutalizing. If you could get it yourselves, you'd already have it. If I'm wrong, shoot.
Sir.
Shoot me! Squeeze that trigger! Don't look there. Look at the target. That's right.
What are your orders, sir? I need orders to proceed. The chaplain grabs the lieutenant's wrist and pushes the gun to the side. Using an Aikido move, he pins the lieutenant's arm against her shoulder and forces it to her knees.
Drop it. Now or I'll snap it.
The gun falls to the floor. The chaplain retrieves it and points it at control.
This ends now. Understand? Do you understand? Get out of there, soldier. We're done.
Aren't you a man of action? Wasn't that impressive?
I said get up, soldier. We're out of here.
And where do you intend to go?
You're not going anywhere, you fuckface. And you broke my fucking nose.
I'll shoot.
Haven't we just done this?
I want passage out of here.
There is no here.
Are you listening?
Do you really think he'll call back?
Come on out of there, soldier.
Can you fire on real people as easily as you fired on the enemy?
You are the enemy. My country doesn't do things like this.
But what does your country do then?
It does...
Yes.
It respects fundamental law. It embraces common decency. It shows compassion.
How many terrorists did you take out? Can someone help me out?
Seven, sir. Seven dragons blown to hell. Outstanding.
Wasn't that...
Shut the hell up.
Fuck this guy. He won't do it.
Soldier, come on.
Fuck you. Fuck you and your fucking monkey. Look at him shake. He's gonna piss himself.
Is that right? You gonna piss yourself, chaplain?
You ain't got shit.
Shut up.
Seriously, Sergeant, I wouldn't do that.
Fuck you. Fuck you, you fucking
sir, I don't think that the sergeant is aware.
Oh, wouldn't it be more fun if he's surprised?
About what?
Reverend.
About what?
Listen to God. He's speaking right now.
No.
You feel his grace?
That's right. Use the force, nigga Jim.
I don't feel anything.
Shit, look at him. He's got nothing.
Don't. Don't you...
Fuck this.
The chaplain pulls the trigger.
Oh, fuck!
The chaplain pulls
fuck,
the trigger.
Fuck, fuck,
dead,
fuck, fuck!
Dead. Click, click, click. Sir?
You don't think we'd let a decorated hero anywhere near live?
Me.
Do you require medical attention, Sergeant? How about a thesaurus?
Your actions inspired many of us, sir. I commend you for your service.
What are you talking about?
Sir, the Silver Star...
It's a goddamn piece of tin.
Sergeant, would you be bothered to secure the prisoner?
Yeah.
What?
Sir, yes, sir.
Fuck.
Regardless, sir, you you of my admiration and gratitude. If I am ever fortunate enough to serve my country in combat,
Sweet Mother of God, will you please stop talking?
I just want to say, as a fellow soldier...
Soldier? Soldier? Is that what you call yourself, you little punk?
Sir,
I wasn't even supposed to be there, kid. I wasn't a soldier, I was a goddamn chaplain. Filling in for some Presbyterian with a bad gallbladder. 20 minutes out, an RPG took out the second vehicle in the convoy. Shrapnel went everywhere. Kid in front of me, pretty girl like you, got hit bad. I'm down low, crawling, gagging on sand, trying to hear something other than the roar in my ears. Do you know what the dirt tastes like over there, Shade Tail? It's bitter.
Alkali.
Shut the fuck up! You're an expert then? Tell me what you do when the rounds ricochet inside your vehicle. When men you led in prayer an hour before bail out and catch it from both sides. When they're chopped into bloody meat and oozing into that bitter goddamn soil. Tell me what you do. Tell me what you do!
It's hypothetical, sir.
Fuck you. Silver Star shit. All I did was pick up some poor grunt saw. I found myself shooting, pounding away until I thought the barrel would melt. Grabbed extra magazines from this screaming kid, burned almost blind from the RPG hit, I think. I just kept firing. I knew that I'd get hit. I knew I'd go down. And I never did. Later, my ears came back and I heard the shriek like a terrified girl throbbing in my head, and it took a while to figure out that it was me. Fuck you.
Sir, we should proceed.
You married, kid?
That's not germane, sir.
After I rotated home, I shoved my wife's face through a plate glass window. I carry that. So does she. I live with it every day. Still see the wounded lying there on both sides. I hear them call to their mother, sometimes in a language that I don't understand, but still do. Body splayed in the dirt, or a round stopped him dead, my round maybe. That's when I saw it for what it was. We're the bad guys. Us. You, Shade Tail. They're fighting for their homes, the land they grew up on, against invaders. In their places, I'd have done the same thing. I hope the son of a bitch who killed me never truly slept again.
Are you going to regale us with the death of your kitten now, or can we get back to work? How can we move beyond this?
Of yours. He was right. I have nothing.
So what are you trying to tell me?
Didn't you hear me? I'm done.
Have you forgotten our agreement?
Jesus Christ, I had every intention of killing a man. I'm no good to you, no good to that soldier.
Aren't you underestimating yourself?
I don't think I can even get out of this chair.
To tell the truth, who would blame you?
The buzzer sounds. The sergeant, now is
that about?
Well, we have to continue on our own now, don't we?
Continue? Look, he's disturbed, damaged.
Really? Who doesn't shout up God from time to time, don't you?
He needs treatment, compassion.
Why should I care what a murderer needs?
Well, for God's sake, the man is just this side of deranged. Nothing you beat from him will be remotely reliable. I don't know why you're bothering.
Why am I bothering? Why should I even continue this conversation? Why shouldn't I turn both of your cases over to the Inspector General and stop wasting my time?
It would be a relief. So, get me out of here.
Would you like to say goodbye?
The chaplain looks through the cell, with a sergeant and the prisoner strapping the prisoner tightly to the gurney. He jumps to his feet.
What in God's name are you doing to him?
Didn't you just tell me you couldn't get out of the chair?
I said, what are you doing?
You don't know.
For the love of God.
Oh, what does that have to do with anything?
Don't do it, please.
The sergeant places a towel over the prisoner's face.
Haven't we wasted enough time already?
The sergeant slowly pours water onto the towel. This box gags and struggles furiously against the tree.
Stop it! Leave him alone!
The sergeant explains, sir, there is no him. She slams a magazine into her recovered sidearm and chambers the first round. And regardless of my feelings, I will blow you away, sir. Inside the cell, the waterboarding continues. The sounds and struggles are horrific.
There is no point to this. I can do it. He was on the verge of opening up. I know it was. Let me back in. I can get what you want. You don't have to torture him. Oh, Jesus. Look, you don't have to do this. He doesn't deserve this. Not this.
Have you considered that it might be about you?
What?
Who assaulted my personnel? Who waved a gun around in my facility? Who made demands?
Stop this, please.
Can we do something about that noise?
Sir, the lieutenant hits a switch on the side of the cell. The loudspeakers fall silent, but the now muted struggles continue within.
He is mentally ill. In the name of God, please stop. I promise.
Why should I listen to a promise from you? What have you delivered so far?
I'm close.
What is your fucking point?
I'm close. I just need a little more.
Yes, you need a little more time. Is that it?
I can do it. I will do it. Just stop it. My God, just stop it.
What do you think is going through that soggy brain? Is he thinking about you, perhaps? Given the circumstances, who wouldn't?
God, I'm sorry. God, I'm so sorry.
Do you want it to end? Do you want it to end?
Yes.
What was that?
Yes, I want it to end.
Can you get the information we require?
I'll try.
What did he say, Lieutenant?
He said he'd try, sir.
Maybe have a little background music?
Yes, sir. The lieutenant flicks the switch.
I'll get anything you want, please!
Sounds and the waterboarding stops. Inside the cell, the sergeant removes the body of the prisoner.
Thank you.
You really think your whining had anything to do with it?
The lieutenant enters the cell and assists the sergeant in removing the prisoner from the gurney. They strap a small device to his chest and attach electrodes along both sides of his torso.
Can you finish the job?
Yes.
Can you imagine the circumstances?
After what I've seen today? Yes, I can. I can fucking imagine anything.
What event?
The sergeant and lieutenant leave the prisoner mute and trembling in a corner of the cell. They wheel the gurney outside. The prisoner is yours, sir, and between us, I wouldn't waste any time, sir.
That thing strapped to him?
Do not touch the apparatus at any time, sir.
I ask you what the...
He knows when you've been bad or good. So be good, for goodness sake.
God, suck. Are you all right? Soldier. I'm so sorry. How can any of this... What? How can any of this be funny?
No, it ain't funny. It's hilarious, more like it. Those fellas, they're real comedians, yes, sir.
The sergeant holds a device that resembles the remote control for a toy car.
Soldier, these men will stop at nothing. They won't think twice about...
It don't matter. I'm out of here. When I was on that table, the Lord whispered to me. He said, you ain't long for this worth.
No. God doesn't want you to die.
I ain't gonna die. The Lord's gonna take me up in a rocket ship, see? Leave the earth to Satan and his slaves. We're gonna fly away, God and me, and anybody who'll come. We're gonna land right on the sun and live there forever in the pure light of the Lord.
You can't do that, soldier. It's not going to happen.
Give me one reason.
Think about it, for God's sake. You know you can't take a spaceship to the sun. You'd burn up.
Well, I reckon so. That's why we're going to go at night. That's a joke, you know. The last part, at least.
So?
An
Another one of Granddaddy's when he told it the rocket was full of Irishmen or Polacks or something. Once there was a...
Look, do you have any idea how serious this is?
I'm naked, cuffed, half drowned, and probably got a couple of busted ribs. No, I ain't got a clue how serious this is. You gotta lighten up, Reverend.
Those men could come in here at any moment. You've got to give them something. Anything.
Oh, if they do, you can kick butt again. You gave that one what for? I ain't never seen a preacher throw a more wicked punch.
We need to talk about your squad.
We need to talk about your soul.
This is wasting what little time we have, soldier.
He talked to you out there, didn't he?
Please, for the love of God.
You put yourself on the line because of me. Fought the good fight because of me. That's what the Lord does. He leads us to the right thing. Always.
No one spoke to me.
He's beside you right now. Let him comfort you.
I have to be very clear about this. We need to talk about the here and now, about your squad. Any moment that buzzer will sound and those men will come in here, and I don't know what they'll do. Do you understand? Do you understand?
Yeah.
8 men dead. Your weapon, your rounds. They need to know what really happened. No Jesus, no voices. They need facts, soldier. It's as simple as that.
Squeezing off a round's as simple as it gets, ain't it? Ain't it, Reverend Jim?
It's complicated.
After all this, I know you can feel me. That's what I had to find out, see? I needed to see if you got me. Silver Star. Body count. We's brothers, maybe, in another life. Brothers in arms. Brothers in the Lord.
I have a damn medal. You know why? Because I was in a place no man should be. Because I did things no man should do. I saw the other side soldier, and it was far from God as I ever dared imagine. I think you've seen that place, too. Now, help me understand what it was like for you.
All right. But there's one thing, see, something you ain't expected. What I carry inside, that's my burden. When I tell it, it ain't mine no more.
That's right. You'll be free of it, light as a feather.
Maybe, but you won't. Once I tell it, it's yours, get it?
I think so.
No matter what happens, God has never loved you more than right now, Reverend Jim.
Soldier?
That's the truth. Uh-oh. Punchline.
The sergeant pushes a button on the remote, and a red light... Ah!
Jesus Christ, what's wrong?
They shot me!
Why are you doing this, Jim? What in God's name are you doing?
The chaplain approaches the prisoner and reaches for the device. As he does, its light flashes.
You son of a bitch! You can kill him passing a current to his heart, do you know that? You can kill him, do you know that? You can't do this! You can't do this! We don't do things like this! We aren't like this!
Jim, don't take it personal.
No. No, for God's sake!
I'll tell you the truth.
Sergeant switches off the remote.
Soldier, it shouldn't happen like this.
It ain't because of them. It's because of you.
Soldier, I don't want you.
I won't talk for you. He did this all day, and I wouldn't talk for you. I'll do it for him. He's a good man. A man of God. He don't deserve this. Ask me your questions, Reverend. Maybe you can get out of here at least.
I don't have any more questions. I don't know where I am. I don't know who we are. I don't know how this could happen.
You gotta step up, Reverend.
I have nothing for you.
You won the Silver Star. You were strong then. You've been strong today. You gotta be strong now. Stronger than me. I can't do this by myself.
I can't.
Reverend, look at me, Reverend. Jim, you got to do this.
All right. Go on. It's your story.
You already know how it ends.
Then tell me how it started.
Started, I reckon, when P.P., you know, Freddie, died.
Uh-huh. All right. Tell me about Freddy.
We was on neighborhood patrol just outside the zone, sort of like being the town cops, you know? We got to recognize most folks, and they knew us, too. A little nod when we passed, that kind of thing. Casual, like, routine. Freddy, he was up on point. He was looking back at us and telling the story about a horse and a bartender. I had my eyes up scanning the rooftops when Freddy stopped talking. I waited a second, but he didn't pick up again. Then I heard Sarge yelling, "Shooter," or "Gun," or something. I looked forward, Freddy was down, and Sarge, he was covered in red speckles like measles. He wiped it out of his eyes as he kept yelling. Somebody pointed to a house about 50 meters down the street. This guy out front, I kind of knew him. Spoke English, said hello, and good morning when we passed. Everybody started shooting.
Did you start shooting?
Yeah. I don't know at what. I didn't see nothing but the one guy living in the street. Everybody advanced on the house, shooting, kicked down the door, shot inside. I was the last in. Two males down, a female down.
A female.
I recognized her. She always smiled. Pretty. The others, I thought I knew them too.
The guns?
No. Not none I see.
Go on. Be strong, soldier. We can do this together.
The woman, she was the mom, I think. Shot bad, but alive. She screamed. Sarge, he yelled right back. He told her to stop, but she kept on and on. And Sarge, he went all rip shit like I've never seen him. Went on about Freddy and how she killed him. She didn't. I knew she didn't, and I think he knew too. But it didn't seem like he cared. Freddy was dead, and there she stood, alive, right in front of him.
And then? Soldier.
That's all.
What did your sergeant do? Soldier, you have to go on.
Sarge. He got personal with her. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The guys, they walked. Some hollered at her, bad names. A few laughed. One, he took pictures while it went on.
Pictures?
A movie on his phone. They watched it over and over that night. They all sat and drank, talked about Freddy and laughed and cried and drank.
A movie?
Yeah. You okay? You don't look so good. Reverend?
Your sergeant, did he try to stop them?
No.
Did you try to stop him?
No. No. Scared, I guess. Didn't know what to do, ashamed.
The woman?
Sarge finished with her. He told us all to get out and secure the area. He heaved in a couple of grenades as he left. Blew the devil out of the place, and he called for help to evac Freddy. Said we was all in it and not to talk.
And you told no one?
No. I'm sorry.
No, no, no. You're doing the right thing now.
She seemed like a nice lady. I seen her once or twice, just went about her business like normal. Like somebody else's army weren't crawling all over her town. She made do just like folks back home. It weren't like they'd shoot at us. It don't make no sense. A couple of weeks later, we was back on patrol, same neighborhood. Girl comes down the street, opposite side, goes into a house. She looks young, maybe 12, 13. Sarge goes, "I see a gun."
Did you see a gun? Did you see a gun, soldier?
No. Sarge split us up, took six with him, when he kicked in the door, left me and another guy, this Mexican guy, Rafael, left us outside to watch the street. He was shooting and yelling, and I heard this girl scream. I thought it was a cat or something for a minute, but it was a girl for sure. I don't like talking about this.
You have to, soldier. Just lay your burden at my feet. It's all right.
This is far from all right as I can picture.
Did you see what happened inside the house?
I peeked in.
You looked in and...
I seen Sarge. Saw him on her. Like with that other woman. And this older woman was laying on the floor, killed. And the guys laughed and cheered while Sarge, you know... And the same guy, he stood there making another movie of it all.
Jesus Christ.
Lord, he don't got nothing to do with this business.
The soldier. Tell me his name.
Which one?
Shooting the video.
That'd be Lester. Lester Atkinson. Tight with Freddie, with Sarge, too.
Oh, my God.
You okay, Reverend? Reverend?
Just go on.
The guys, they took turns with her. All of them, Raphael too. After a bit, they stuffed a rag in her mouth to keep her quiet, wrapped a belt around her head to keep it in. I didn't do nothing, though. I held back. It felt awful, Reverend. I should have done something. Reverend? Reverend, are you...
In that room? The wall, something on the wall.
I don't follow, Reverend.
There was a picture on the wall. Did you see a picture on the wall?
It runs together.
A white horse at full gallop?
Yeah. Maybe I've seen that. How did you...
Just finish your story.
That day, the one where I got in trouble, it started the same way. We rolled up, and I'd never seen the place so quiet, not in this war. There's a passel of kids outside, running, doing what kids do. An older girl came up, teenager maybe, and she shooed him into the house when we got close. Then I heard Sarge go, "I see a gun." The guys rolled out of the Humvee and double-timed it toward the buildings. Me, I was up top with my saw. Right before everybody took position, Sarge, he looked back at me. He grinned. I still see his teeth. The rest of it happened like I said. They all hunkered down, Sarge and Lester and the rest. And they opened up on the plate. And then in the middle of the shooting and hollering, I seen the Lord in the sky. 100 stories tall, like I said. And I heard the voice of the Lord plain as day, like I said.
Protect my sheep.
Like I said.
And you shot him.
Each of them fell like their bones turned to water. I couldn't miss, seemed like. The whole time, the Lord had his hand on my shoulder. He whispered in my ear. I felt his breath. He said, "Soon you will be with me." Do you believe me, Reverend?
I believe you shot him. I believe you had your reasons.
Do you believe me?
I believe you had no choice.
Do you believe me about the Lord?
A couple of months ago, when I was still in country, an officer came to me for counseling. It was a young guy attached to the Inspector General's office. He was troubled, to say the least. You know why? A video card turned up in the effects of a KIA, an enlisted man. And on that card, you can barely speak about it. Rape and murder of civilians. Rape and murder by our own troops. Families. Children. The brass did what he expected. Nothing. Not with another goddamn surge on the way. Not with public opinion ready to derail with one more horror story. Those images would sink it all. It was a political nightmare. you need men who know that a horrible reality still trumps a gift-wrapped lie. And that officer is one of them.
Maybe you are too.
He switched out the card before anybody had a chance to wipe the evidence. He put it on my desk and said that he trusted me to do the right thing. A man that he'd never met before. He probably thinks I've turned him in.
You didn't, right? I know you didn't.
I claimed a family emergency and hopped the first transport home. And when I went up to Canada trying to buy some time, figure out what to do, and the MPs grabbed me when I came back across the border. 24 hours later, I'm here with you.
He's in this because of me.
I was stupid enough to believe it was all because I went AWOL. Bullshit. I'll never make a desertion charge stick. Jesus Christ, they just wanted the two of us together.
That soldier, he said you'd do the right thing. You are, right?
Sorry I got you into this mess, soldier. My God, I don't even know your name.
Hey, Reverend.
You sure? To meet you.
Likewise. Do you believe me? Do you believe that God spoke to me? He speaks to us all, Reverend. He spoke to you today. He spoke to you back when that soldier came to you. He whispered in your ear, "Be my servant." Didn't you hear it?
I didn't hear anything.
The same, the two of us. He said it to you too. Protect my sheep. You heard him. I know you did.
I didn't hear anything.
He told me that God doesn't want us to stand by. God, see, he gave you the power to make this right. You can get that video to the world. You can stop these men. You can stop all of this. The Lord spoke to you. Look at me, Reverend. Look in my eyes. The Lord spoke to me. He spoke to you. Look in my eyes and tell me if you believe me.
I don't know.
You do. Tell me what you know. Look at me and you tell me what's in your heart.
I believe you.
Praise God. He's given you the power. You know that, right?
I don't
You know he spoke to you.
I just wanted to do what's right.
And you heard him.
Yes.
You know where that card is, don't you? Reverend, you know where it is, right? Are you going to protect his sheep? Reverend, are you going to protect his sheep?
Yes.
In the name of God?
I'll publish it. In the name of God.
Will you speak the truth? Hallelujah.
The light on the prisoner's device blinks on.
No!
The buzzer sounds. The sergeant opens the door.
Out. But he talked. He told everything. Why would you?
Get out now. You're done.
I believe in you, Reverend.
This way, sir. Please, have a seat.
Do you realize that we already can charge you with treason?
What?
The word is treason, sir.
Based on what? I spoke in my capacity as a chaplain. It was privileged communication.
Doesn't that work for him, but not for you? And besides, haven't you heard?
The sergeant kicks the prisoner.
Oh!
There's a war on, sir.
Leave that man alone!
Do you mean the one that killed 8 comrades?
After this comes out, there probably won't even be any charges.
Why would anyone need to charge a dead man?
The sergeant levels his sidearm at the prisoner's head.
No, 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 you can't shoot him!
There is no him.
But when I leave here!
There is no here, sir.
Do you see your dilemma?
You won't do it.
Another kick.
Oh.
Where's the item?
I don't believe you.
Third kick.
Oh. Well, for God's sake!
Yes?
Me! Take me! He can't help you!
What do you think?
Loving it, sir.
Do it! Strap me to the gurney! Shock me! I don't care! You'll never get anything
more! You still consider the prisoner an asset, sir?
What prisoner?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Jesus!
What? No! You can't!
Do you have something to tell us?
Stop! Stop in the name of God!
Do you
stop!
Have something to tell us? Do you have...
Yes!
So you understand, I'm doing it for him, not me. And not for the likes of you. Montreal. I mailed it to a post office on Rue Atwater. Box 1511.
The sergeant holsters his weapon and proceeds immediately to the telephone. He punches in numbers and stays on the line.
Now, Captain, oh, Major. Wasn't that easy?
Yeah. Easy.
Seriously? You didn't really believe that psychotic's hogwash, did you?
Yes.
Why the sad face? Don't you know you're still very valuable to your country?
Worthless.
You're a decorated combat veteran, aren't you? Don't you think there's a use for that? What about public relations? How'd you like to sell some war bonds? Wouldn't that be great? Do we even have war bonds anymore? Does anyone know? Who cares? A great photo op is a great photo op, right?
Did you ever have a swing-shaped tail?
Sir?
You know, when you were a kid.
That's not germane, sir.
Is the team in place?
Yes, sir. ETA 90 seconds.
Sure you did. You probably had the works, a fancy swing set and a slide, am I right?
Respectfully,
the old man rigged one for me, just a loop of rusty chain and a board hanging off the old apple tree. I'd go to town on it, though. Thought if I stretched out far enough, I might even tickle the sky with my tiptoes.
60 seconds.
Must have been, I don't know, 9 or 10. I looked past my toes into the blue, and I watched cloud, this big billowing summer cloud drift over the sun. As soon as it did, boom, these beams of light burst through to my kid's eyes. It looked like a crown in the sky. In the middle of it, in the middle of it all, I saw a figure ablaze with light. It's just part of the cloud, really, but all white mist. For a moment, it looked like a man with outstretched arms, and I thought to myself, it's Jesus. He's going to come down right here in the backyard. And then I let go, and I flew out of the swing and ran inside as hard as I could because I figured that Jesus would be pretty scary, and I didn't want to be scared.
Stand by.
Once in a while, even now, I think, what if that wasn't a cloud? What if it was really Jesus and I blew it? What if I'll never know?
Hoo-ah! Yes!
Is the item secure?
Yes, sir. Good guys win again.
Jesus in the sky. I mean, is that dumb or what?
It's not germane, sir.
Today it is. It's germane because today I believe in inherent goodness of man, that the mystery of grace can be revealed in a common soldier, that the least of us can touch the divine. What do they call you, kid?
Shall we wrap this up?
Our policy, sir.
It's germane today.
Excuse me.
The lieutenant begins to unroll a 9x12 carpet and position it against a bare wall in clear view of the audience.
Anybody else ready for a drink?
A gunshot. Very loud.
What was that? What in God's name was that? What did you do? soldier?
He's dead, Jim.
The sergeant and lieutenant finish positioning the carpet. They then hang a makeshift flag on the wall just above it.
Private?
The flag depicts a dragon entwined with indecipherable symbols as well as the English word truth.
Private! Private Johns! Private Rupert Johns! Private Rupert Preston Johns!
Is the paperwork complete, Lieutenant?
Almost, sir.
A man deserves his name.
The lieutenant approaches after the hanging of the flag and points to a document on the table.
A man deserves his name!
Yes, sir. May I direct your attention to the document in front of you? Form 93, quite standard. Do you wish to update your beneficiary? The director wants to be thorough and fair.
In my country, a man has his name.
Of course, sir. Please, on the line. Right here.
A man!
Please, sir.
My father. He lives.
Very good, sir.
My father. Bless his heart.
He shaved tail. Why'd the agnostic cross the road?
Sir?
Just tell me.
Sir, that doesn't seem...
A simple question. Why did the agnostic cross the road?
I don't know, sir.
Exactly.
I just want to say, your father, you've forgiven him?
Yeah.
And your wife, is she?
I don't know. Please tell me your name. You're someone's daughter, someone's sister, someone loves you. You have a name.
He reaches out and removes her sunglasses.
Thank you. Thank you for your service.
We can get out of here.
She wavers for a moment. Then extends her right hand. Before clasping his, however, she produces a stun gun in her left and shocks him with it. The sergeant cuffs the chaplain's hands behind him. The sergeant and lieutenant don white hoods and lead the chaplain to the carpet where he's roughly forced to his knees.
I believe in the inherent goodness of man. That the mystery of grace can be revealed to a common soldier. That the least of us can touch the divine. I believe in the inherent goodness of man. I believe in the inherent goodness of man. I believe that a common soldier. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. I lay down my life for my sheep. The Lord is my...
The sergeant and lieutenant stuff a length of cloth into the chaplain's mouth and wind tape it up his head to secure it. They pick up AK-47 rifles and stand flanking the flag. An executioner dressed in a blue hood sets up a video camera and presses record, then approaches the chaplain and flicks open the stiletto blade. We hear a loud recording in a strange, unknown language.
Mm-hmm.
Shall we call it a day?
The sergeant and lieutenant removed their hoods, wrapped the chaplain's body in the rug, and lifted onto the gurney. We hear the sound of a vault unlocking, followed by the strains of Frosty the Snowman from the loudspeakers. The lieutenant gathers herself for a moment, dons her sunglasses, and wheels the gurney through the house door and into the lobby.
And I'd like to tap that. Shit you not, man. Anyway, so much for the goddamn Christmas truce, huh? I feel another surge coming on. Hoo-wah! Some kind of day. Fuck me running. You know, I gotta admit, that guy was okay. Come on, I think I owe you an eggnog.
The executioner removes his hood. It's the prisoner.
Don't you ever touch me again, Sergeant.
Yes. Sir, Director, sir.
And turn off that fucking noise!
The sergeant complies and quickly exits through the house doors. The audience is left to fend for itself. End of play.
Conversation about the play, and if we have anybody watching on the video and would like to participate in the talk back as well, we'll get your comments in here. So I know this is one of those where, you know, you kind of have to process and sort of take things in a little bit, but and maybe not. But I'd like to share sort of to start off sharing what you're feeling right now. And I realize that you might not want to talk, you know, but can somebody just be brave and kind of tell me, like, what you're feeling right in this very moment. And the actors can participate in this as well.
I'm tired.
I want to slit my wrist.
You want to slit your wrist?
I know every time we get to the last thing and he's saying, you know, I lay down my life for my chief, I'm like, I have to read this stage right now. I just want to, like, fall out of my chair and start crying. It's just...
Yeah.
I get dead inside.
Feel dead inside.
Disillusioned, unhappy, miserable.
Yes.
So it was a comedy.
Yeah. A lot of laughter. Can you tell me a little bit about maybe some of the images or things that stuck with you, you know? Like what you'll be thinking about later tonight?
Well, the various images that we talked about, the various events. I mean, we've all seen some footage.
Yeah.
Now, this is sort of like being able to see more footage.
Yeah.
None of it very pleasant.
Right.
But very vivid.
Yeah.
Very vivid descriptions of those incidents.
Yeah, absolutely.
For me, the stuff about the rooster, you know, and the big bird on the wall crowing, and all the stories are really well illustrated for me. Like the, you know, the chaplain has the line, I say, you know what I mean? He says, you describe it well, I can picture it, you know? Mm-hmm. That to me,
there's a lot of poetry.
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of poetry. And the imagery of it is even in these tiny little slip moments that, like the whole thing, I come into this now after reading it the first time. I came into it every time after that, but the first image in my head when I'm on stage of the picture of the white horse riding.
That is the most stunning thing in the whole play.
And it's a glimpse. It's just this tiny,
because it finally ties them together.
Yeah.
Before that, there's no tie.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about what you experienced in the moment where you kind of realized there was more happening, when that video, you know, when that piece of information about the white horse gallop, you know, full gallop, can you describe what was happening for you there? I mean, where were you in the story?
It happened for me when the good shepherd or taking care of the sheep line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's when it happened. I was like, oh, there's some other connection here between the two of them.
Oh, yeah, okay.
That's when it happened.
That's
protect,
when it happened. For
protect
you.
My sheep.
Protect my sheep.
Yeah. Other places for you all? I mean, did it happen earlier for anybody?
Hey, Lauren. I'm really slow on picking up stuff like that.
No,
my wife gets it like an hour before I do. when I found out the prisoner was the director, it was effective, but it caused me to reprocess
everything.
Because, and so that's still happening at this moment.
Yeah.
But before that moment, which is the last thing that happens, my main focus was the relationship between the chaplain and the prisoner,
mm-hmm.
and what they had in common, and how what was connecting for them. And so when I had to suddenly realize that that wasn't a real relationship, I was like, whoa. Right at the end. So I'm
jerked the rug out from
Did anybody else have other? I mean, did you form a bond, and then can you talk? I mean, can you describe? You feel like the rug was pulled out from under you. And I mean, other people have similar experiences.
I felt like there was some earlier, like, foreshadowing, I guess it was,
mm-hmm.
you know, that there were just a sentence here and there, the man that killed me, you know, that doesn't sleep at night or something like that, and then the prisoner would reference, this is about you, and I started feeling like, really, I started thinking they were the same person, that the prisoner was really his conscience.
Yeah.
You know, that he was struggling with. Early on.
Yeah. No.
My character's line, there is no him, that
yes,
I say.
Exactly.
Right,
a lot,
right.
You
know,
exactly.
They're being
going
more.
Back and working on it again,
mm-hmm.
you know. I
yeah.
thought of
mm-hmm.
my character
sure.
watching
mm-hmm.
it all as if, you know,
right.
even that time I was sitting through and going, guys, making this up as we go.
Right.
Isn't this crazy? Oh, I gotta smack
yeah.
it around a little bit.
yeah, even
yeah.
a lot of that is just so well done for me because every time I get to the end of this play, like you said, I process everything in retrospect.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And everything, there are hints here and there. And there are even lines that, I don't know, this really tickles me, but the director is occupied.
Yeah. And I would do takes over and look at him whenever they said that. He's occupied.
Yeah, those of us who've been in lab and kind of working with it, it's you know, we spend a lot of time trying to track backwards through
mm-hmm.
it, you know what I mean, and then we're in the rehearsal process as well, trying to, what are the tactics the prisoner's then taking to get the information out. Yeah.
There were two moments, and I don't know if there were more, it's just
yeah.
I started to pick up on, and I didn't know if it was a directorial choice or if it was in the script,
sure.
but when he gets the water, and then the officers start drinking water as well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, one, it makes me want to get my water out.
Yeah.
But I noticed the trio happening, and then there was another one when everybody was scratching their chins together.
Oh.
But is that something that was directed that way?
Well, the water thing is in the script, because the water thing, at the moment where he starts drinking the water,
mm-hmm.
bottles of water have been passed
mm-hmm.
out to the audience,
right.
you know, and then
mm-hmm.
in the reading situation. But and so I think the intention of the playwright, who's silent right now, but we'll come up here in just a minute to answer any questions, is that that then, you know, you all have been given bottles of water, and you see this guy retching, and so, you know, what is that?
The chin scratching must be a climate thing.
Yeah, the chin scratching. I have no idea about that.
Do you remember
scratching.
When that happened? Just out of curiosity.
I'm curious after the water.
I
yeah,
do.
Water.
It was on 67, like we agreed.
you know, it sort of made me think. Are there well,
right? What are the?
There's some mystery.
Sure,
happening.
Sure. And in a full staging, that might be something that certainly, like, you know, we talked very briefly about sort of the guards' looks, you know, when they're not in the space, you know. But there would be all those things to explore in the production.
I'm really gullible.
Yes.
You know, and it was really, you know, I really liked the prisoner.
Mm-hmm.
And then to find that he turned on me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was just like, at the end, everybody was clapping. I was like, what?
Don't clap for him. Don't you dare.
Yeah. So
just, I mean, there's that hollow.
Yeah,
like
there's
that
just that hollow feeling, yeah. Yeah. Yes, Rich.
Well, I feel duped. I feel betrayed. I'm mad at you. But I can't help
wonder, even being faced with all the awful things that these people are doing, did you all have a connection still? Did you have to, were you
totally
touched? Because I got
totally
that impression,
so.
But it still worries
I
me
totally
a lot.
Think so, and that came through an evolution of the script. There was a,
Yeah, is it a comment or?
Yeah, it's really funny. Someone just tweeted, really powerful, great job, folks. I feel betrayed.
And before you go any further, because I'm interested to see what other people thought, did anybody else feel at the ending with the, and it, you know, may, that the prisoner felt remorse for what he had done? Mm-hmm. Did anybody feel that or not
well,
at all?
I did kind of just because of what he said to him. Don't, what do you say, don't touch me?
Don't you ever
right,
touch me.
Don't ever touch
okay.
me. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cool. No, I was just, I'm just curious, you know, if you felt like, you know, if there was anything on his side. Some of you are saying no, and some are saying maybe.
I feel like there totally was, but he's still the director of this organization type thing. You know.
Yeah.
On that, because that line is so bitter. You know, and when I first read it, I was like, oh, he's just mad because he got waterboarded. but that was part of the script. You know, that was something that was planned. It's not like he's mad at his subordinate for following out the orders. And so that this time it really came across to me, and it's like, I'm not ready to go drink eggnog with you and, you know, ogle the other soldier.
I really like just that thing that evolved from it was the director lingers, the prisoner lingers at the end. And that was one of my favorite things about the evolution of this script. Was that before it was like, turn that noise off. I'm out of here.
Where's my Ferrari?
I hate Frosty the Snowman. That was the true part. And then, it has evolved into he lingers. And I think that there is a, even if it's just a, you know, small genuine connection, there's still some connection there between them.
I always like it when no one gets off easy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's the person that killed me never slept again.
Right.
You know?
I want to ask one more question before we bring the playwright up, and that I just want to hear maybe really briefly what you think this play is about. Like, if you go home tonight and you say, I saw this play and it was about blank, what would you say?
I wouldn't, because there was a moment where I was like, am I getting a message?
Sure.
And then you start to find the twist, and then it raises all these questions,
mm-hmm.
and I think it would be very exciting with the technology.
Yeah.
Making the experience, raising even more questions so that when
sure.
you walk away, you're not.
Yeah, you don't have, that's
answer.
Not what you're thinking
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's about honor.
Honor.
Because it seems to me the director has made the decision that the chaplain is a traitor, but he's also a hero, and he doesn't want him to die as a traitor.
Yeah.
He wants him to die as a hero. And he goes through all this rigmarole to bring the chaplain to the point that
mm-hmm.
he can die as a hero and not as a traitor.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah.
The thing that always sticks with me, I'm a part of Lab, so I've experienced the play many times. The most powerful thing for me is I agree, I don't know that I would say this is what the play is about because it's so, you know, loaded. But the thing that always sticks with me that I always, always question and think about and wonder over is that declaration that the chaplain has at the end when he says, I believe in the common grace and I believe.
Mm-hmm.
He's just experienced the most horrific experience anyone could ever experience, and yet he still has come to this conclusion that the inherent goodness of man and that the common grace can be revealed to a soldier. I'm always questioning, like, what does that mean? And how does that happen?
Yeah.
And so from in many ways that's what the play is about for me in terms of reaching grace.
Yeah.
Through what?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Holly, did you want to add to that? Did you? You had your hand up.
No, I lost it.
Lost it. You had your hand up.
Well, I really agree with what he was saying. And
yeah.
But for me, it was also the message of. Those individual decisions that we all make, you know, from many times during a day of, you know, sort of like an ethical dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
Do I do what I know is the right thing to do, or and even though it may be perilous to me,
sure.
Or do I just let it go? You know, there are just a lot of those, and not necessarily as big as this, you know, but that we all face every day.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm very upset. But I kept feeling when the chaplain was speaking and saying, this is not who we are, this is not who we are, you know, and this is not like whatever. And as my daughter knows, we've got a lot of other stuff mixed up with this, and this is why she did not want her brother to come see the show.
He's going to the Navy.
Yeah, he's getting ready to go to the Naval Academy. Anyway, I'm just like, this is not who we are, and I know that this goes on, but the darkness of it made me believe, I have to tell you, that the playwright's message is this is who we are,
yeah.
And that there's no light.
There's
and
no
so
light.
It was very hard for me because I felt like it was a statement about the darkness has totally overtaken. And
the goodness.
And there is no, and so while you felt it was about honor, I felt like it was about
the
honor is going to be snuffed out everywhere. What?
We killed it.
We killed it.
Yeah.
That's what we killed it here.
Yeah.
And it's going to be snuffed out, and it's very hard.
Yeah, that's a very hard message. Yeah, absolutely.
It's a tiny spark, but there's almost kind of a potential of that spark managing to get back on the director there at the end, that he's not going to be able to do this again with the same kind of alacrity. He's going to have to stop and consider this. That's one of the only things that I have found that has, you know, that there's any real redemption apart from, you know, the chaplain's personal redemption is this idea of if there's something moving forward, someone's gotten touched by it that can't shake it.
Yeah.
But it's very small.
To me,
yeah.
To me there was a confusion too, a struggle you're having with the lieutenant the whole time too, and you're like, is she being affected by this, you know? Is there this, like, growth that's happening in her? And then she stun guns him.
No! Don't do it!
In a certain sense, it seems to me that the key line is one that repeats all the way through about we were at war.
Mm. Yeah, there's
I can't
a war
remember
on.
Quite, oh,
yeah,
there's
a war
it's
on.
There's
a war
on. And it's very specific, I mean, there's a great deal of specificity to, I assume, the war or wars that we are in, but it's a much more generalized sense too, and that this is maybe what you can expect when a war is
in
on.
Wartime.
And if a war is always on, this
is
what
it. Yeah, this is it.
Happens and will happen.
Yeah. Based on what some other people talk about. I felt like part of it was asking the audience to ask ourselves, who am I in this play? Especially because of how you set it up.
Right.
And describing
yeah, right.
when we walk in that we're given things,
yeah.
badges or
yeah.
papers, psychology papers
right.
or military papers.
Yeah, redacted military papers.
And
yeah,
so
you're,
immediately
you're
I thought, okay, who am I? We're being forced to participate.
Yeah.
Now,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then with the water bottles being passed out, along
the buckets,
with the buckets,
yeah.
that it's like asking that continual question throughout: who are you in this?
Who are
play?
You in this play? Yeah. No, I think that's certainly something that would be in the actual production.
The coldness.
The coldness
of the speaker.
Yeah.
You did a great job.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah.
we really hated you.
Yes.
And I turned back and I saw this beautiful girl there. I thought, that's
why we had her out of view.
I mean, it was sometimes so soft and loving, and other times it was just so cold and just, oh.
The description is something like she's a cat waiting to pounce on her prey or
yeah,
something
yeah.
like that. So I just took that.
Yeah.
So the chaplain, he bought it all. I mean, he bought everything that the prisoner said. He bought everything that the voice through the microphone was saying. But but he didn't believe about the communication with God. Nobody talks to God. God
right.
doesn't talk to anybody. It's sort of,
yeah,
you know, odd for the chaplain.
Absolutely, yeah, that's a huge, that's a great point.
Well, by the end, he talks about, you know.
Yeah,
well,
and then by the end, he.
But then
he
it was
kind of
in the innate goodness of man, not,
yeah,
not so much in,
not so much
in God.
God.
And it was, you know.
Yeah, that's
well,
a great point.
And at the end, too, he also said, you know, when he was trying to make them stop torturing the prisoner, I mean, you even said, you know, take me or do, you know, let him go. And when after you had read the section about the quote from the Bible about the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep, and I thought that was exactly what you were trying to do.
Well, see, one of the things that I love the most about this role, I pray to God it comes back to me at some point, but there's this lovely dichotomy of a man who's, he's on a specific path. He has seen enough and done enough that he, if he had faith, at some point he lost it. And he's trying to find it again, and he's actually taking on this job in order to find it. And he's gone Unitarian because he's not entirely sure how, you know, but it's still, you know, it's still, he's hard into that journey. He wants to, and then he gets this video. And says, okay, here's proof that there's no God. And at the same time, in the name of God, this must be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I love
very,
that struggle.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Very interesting. You have something burning, and then I've got
to
bring Kenley.
Well,
I'd
like to. I'm sort of hesitant to do this, but I've been chatting with a guy on the internet for several years now, extensively. His father suffers from post-traumatic stress syndrome,
mm-hmm.
and his mother has mental problems. He's been at home with him for 5 years, feeling like he's a big void in his life when he should have been out being his own self. He locks himself in the room sometimes because he's afraid his mother will kill him. He told me about a week ago that his father had tried to kill him and choke him to death in one of those episodes. The word he always uses when he says who he is that he has honor. And that when he promises to do something, he will keep his promise.
Mm. Yeah.
This is real life.
Yeah.
But it makes me see the play
in that
in a whole different,
sure,
serious life, because this is a real person that I know a lot about.
Yeah, absolutely. No, thank you for sharing that. I mean, it's and what we all bring into the space certainly affects. I'd like to bring Kenley down just so that you guys can have a chance to hear a little bit from him and also get a chance to ask him some questions and for you to respond. So Kenley, will you come up and join us? Kenley, will you tell us a little bit about where this play came from, just very briefly, kind of the genesis of this play?
Well, it's a very different kind of piece for me. I mean, there are a lot of the same themes of faith and identity coming from it, but I guess when you accept me into the lab this year, you kind of called me a bluff, because I had this notion, this idea that I want to do something a lot more political, perhaps a lot more topical. And honestly, as of September 1st, it didn't exist except in some notes. And so for the next 30 days, the first draft came together. A lot of prose in it, just a lot of ideas, big ideas, just trying to figure out where it was going to go. And originally, the first notion was it was going to be pretty much a straight interrogation.
Mm-hmm.
And about halfway into that first draft, he had one of those what if moments. What if the director is really, and I decided to plug that in and see how it worked. And I really liked where that took it. I mean, it took it to an incredibly dark place. I mean, it's very clearly the darkest thing I've ever, you know, delved into. And also because of that twist, it's been the most difficult thing.
Sure.
Because then I had to engineer everything in almost from the back end.
Sure.
To make it all work, and that was a lot of the work in lab, is to make that consistent, to eliminate those lingering questions. And the biggest problem, when you're looking at even the normal beats in the play, the real objective is submerged everybody's real objective is something else.
Mm-hmm.
They're overtly doing this or that, but then there's something else going on, and I had to make that honest and realistic as much as possible, and look at in every moment, what is the prisoner's tactic here? Why is he taking the conversation this way or that way? What's that strategy? What's the chaplain's strategy? I mean, he has a goal too. I mean, he's looking out for that pension, trying to make all this good again, and to live the rest of his life with some kind of quality. So everybody has this ulterior motive, and it's been a challenge. It's been a lot of fun. It's been a wild ride.
Yeah, it's been a wild ride. Do you guys have any questions for Kenley?
Well, my question is, I didn't see that the chaplain had that goal at all. I didn't see that he was all that impressed with the idea that he would get the pension, that he would do this, that, and the other. I missed that part. Sorry.
Well,
no, that's a good comment.
I think he evolves very clearly all the way through the play, and of course he has to. I think that's the carrot they give him. That's the whole idea. Hey, we can make this hiccup go away on your record and so forth, but he really becomes involved with this man in the box, and I think he sees his own darkness, the void within, and he's really doing the work of a chaplain again. And maybe that moment he described where he couldn't say anything to this dying soldier. He had nothing to offer. He kept looking for that answer. Maybe this is his final chance to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question that has occurred to me on several occasions over the past 3 or 4 years with the lab. And with all the playwrights, but it struck me, especially tonight, when you're writing, do you concern yourself at all, especially in this phase of development, with what I would just call producibility? I mean, we know that it's all magic, and we can do any number of magical things on stage. Blood, vomit. We had a lot of vomit this year out of the Tennessee Rep. We know how to do that. Boxes, plexiglass boxes, all of those kinds of things. Do you have any concern that the play is maybe limited by what you would most like to have in terms of being able to be produced?
Yes, I think it, as it's described now, I'm sure a lot of theaters would consider it perhaps a daunting possibility. Get past the subject matter and you're looking at just the technical aspect. I'm involved in a New Works theater in Roanoke, Virginia. And whenever I write anything, I always like to have some idea how this might actually be produced. I know a lot of writers just throw it out there and say, well, I'll trust, you know, the crew, and they'll make it happen. But I don't put it in unless I have a solution, and particularly when I think about my own situation. I mean, we're a 60-seat black box in our biggest configuration with a minimal budget, and in my mind, I know how we can do this. We could conceivably do it well and economically. So every little bit I've gone over in my head, so I don't believe I'm asking too much for even a small theater company to you know, make this happen.
Would the male nudity be a blockage?
It simply depends on the theater and what kind of a risk they want to take. I know that's a big stretch for anybody. And I know this is not a play for everybody. It's not a play for every theater company. It's not a play for every audience, clearly. But that's what came out in this moment, and we'll see what happens.
Shane, did we have any? I thought you had your hand up back there. No, okay, good. Okay. Andy.
I have a question that occurred to me during the reading. Textually, they refer to the voice in the back as Sir.
Mm-hmm.
And it's played by a woman, and then we have the woman lieutenant. I'm just wondering about gender specifications and sort of just to hear your thoughts on why they refer to her as a sir.
Mm-hmm. I went with that really hard military protocol. And for this particular situation, it may not be realistic in a true military situation to use sir. I just like the sound of it. But in the later versions of this script, I think maybe from March or April on, originally, I mean, the sergeant and lieutenant, I think, developed more than any characters in the show. When we started out, it was really more of a theater of alienation piece, a very Kafka-esque, and the guards are interchangeable. They were just number one and two, and that was it. And as it went on, I got really more interested in creating defining characteristics for them. They were not gender specific at the beginning, nor was control. But after seeing women read some of these parts and read them very well in the lab sessions, I really decided, I like what's happening here. And I like playing with those ideas of gender and femininity and putting it in this really, really harsh environment and seeing how it works. So the play now very much specifies Lieutenant is a woman, and that's been very much incorporated into the script now. And as is Control, because I love especially what Robin did with it in terms of the voice, where it could be very feminine, very soothing. She can just wrap that voice around every word, and then the claws come out, and it cuts right to the quick.
Yeah,
so,
well, we talked in rehearsal about how that's almost a clue for you as the audience, because the control is really just the stand-in for the director who's otherwise occupied.
Mm-hmm.
So really, when they ask a question, what are my orders, sir? I mean, they're really asking him. I'm just, the substitute teacher in that moment. So it's almost a respect thing that they're saying sir to him, but that I'm just the voice.
Yeah.
One of the nice things about that, I think, is that there's an undercurrent of the play as sort of a study in duplicity, and that, I think, really helps to capture it, the whole idea of people not being what you expect or not what you think they are, and that's true, I believe, of almost every character on the stage in terms of being duplicity, a sort of study of duplicity.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes, sir.
Did you intend, I guess, to put the audience on the defensive, to make the audience have that sense of being complicit in that, the audience is, let's say, with the clipboards and all that stuff, so the audience is part of the interrogation, and, so the audience is automatically coming from a much more defensive sort of view of what's going on, rather than being able to, just be an audience and view and take in and think through. You put them in a position where they're, on the defensive. Was that intentional and important?
Yeah,
very much. Particularly, I've been really interested in environmental theater and really breaking down the barriers between the stage, the audience, and so forth. And as I see it, there would be no platform like this, no stage. If there's any formal seating, it might be just two high risers, maybe in a half or three quarter thrust around this box, and you're right up there close to the action. I didn't want that separation. I didn't want the audience to feel safe and removed. I think as a society, when we, it's very easy to distance ourselves from the harsher things that may be occurring in our names. And I think about myself, how complicit am I in some of the things that might be happening? Many things that I may not agree with, and yet, what am I doing? What is my role? Am I actually allowing it to happen by not taking any action otherwise?
Mm-hmm.
I don't expect this to be anybody's favorite play ever. I expect it to be a play that you don't
you
forget.
Yeah.
The
forget
experience
it.
Should be one that should be, frankly, I hope it's powerful. I hope it's honestly disturbing on some levels. I hope it engenders that type of discussion and thought and with everybody looking within. And I've had to do that process as I've written. I mean, I went to some very, very dark places in it, and places I didn't think I would actually write about. I mean, a lot of my work has been very, very dark, but there's always been something at the end where there's a little uptick, there's a little, you know, mm-hmm. chance. And on this one, even if the chaplain has that moment, he's rediscovered, you know, his purpose, his faith, when his eyes meet the prisoner at that last moment, it's like, it's bullshit.
Yep.
Can I really write this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah.
I know I need to wrap up here, but you have
well, along those lines, if I'm the lucky audience member who gets to use the remote control, what images do you have in mind that go up?
Well, again, I thought, how can you do this economically? So I was thinking really small, like webcam type cameras that would be positioned on the four corners of the cell, then a few places around the space itself. So essentially, you would get just a video switcher, and you would be able to select whatever view. So from inside the cell, you could shoot over the chaplain's shoulder and get a close up.
Okay.
Of the prisoner, or vice versa. You could look at yourselves, and it would vary performance to performance. Click, click, click.
So it's more of a camera operator than seeing any.
Yeah,
kind of
I should have probably described that a little bit better.
Okay.
Probably my
yeah.
bad.
That's a late addition to the script. I just like the idea of that type of interaction, and two. Lauren brought this up in actually directing. Where you have two people in a box on stage, you know, how do you make that dynamic? Well, here you can actually get close up. The audience can vary it as they need, so it's another tool for viewing, and it might very well be something that observers would want to use for whatever, you know, if you're a psychologist out there, if you're another interrogator, if you're trying to take notes, and about which ones are you taking notes, you know? What's your real role?
What a great challenge for an actor in that, you know, you've got a plexiglass wall in front of you, literally creating a fourth wall, so you want to kind of play, you know, past that wall for, I know you said, you know, they're probably not going to be a huge house, but regardless, you want to play past that to get to the last person in the last row, yet you also have a camera, you know, capturing a close-up, which means you need to rein it in a little bit and make it a little smaller, so, whew, I mean,
yeah, what do you do?
Yeah, it's playing for the stage and the screen.
I know we need to wrap up. You have one. You have a burden.
Well, I don't know if this is much a comment or a question. I bought the prisoner so much, I felt like he was the most well-developed character in the entire thing. And so the reason I really felt betrayed
yeah.
at the end was I was like, there's no way the controller could make this guy up. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, I was so with him, and I just felt like all the little idiosyncrasies and all the little... Then when I went back and reflected afterwards, I was like, really? Really this guy could have this, you know, and I mean, I don't know, he was doing a great job with the character. I mean, I was right. But I was just, all those little lines of dialogue, and I was like, wow, that is a really well-realized character. All these things about him, it's so believable. And then I find out, this is the one, you know, this is the controller. So you're just intentionally doing that to to mislead us down this thing? Or does it makes it maybe not be as believable to me at the end because he's so, I don't know, he was such a idiot. You know, he's a character I will remember for a long time. Does anybody want, you want to speak?
That's a good point.
We talked about that a little bit, if I could jump in.
Okay.
We talked about that a little bit of just the why this tactic, right? And it's because the chaplain has nothing to lose is pretty much what we decided at this point. At the point where he enters the play, he has nothing to lose. He's a man without faith, right?
He actually has a line at one point about if he says his name, they'll shoot something. And the chaplain says who? And he said, I'm not willing to find out. When the chaplain comes into the play, the chaplain doesn't really have someone that he's going to lose or someone, you know, he's not in peril.
they have to give him someone to be in peril for in order to make him betray
him. To take it away from him.
Also, just really quick to further that, what's so fascinating about having to backtrack about the twist, and I agree with her in many ways, it's like, oh, he was, what that makes you negotiate that. Consider also his sort of truth.
Yeah.
He obviously has physical abuse scars on his legs.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That they're there. So that story probably is real. So when he's doing this character of prisoner, what's he negotiating?
Yes.
And what's he leaving out and what's he telling? And that's what's so fascinating to me.
Kathleen, you know.
Yeah, I've always kind of wondered, like, what is he, you know, he is making up these stories, I'm assuming, but what of it might be from his own experiences? And, you know, he has scars. Did he just, like, put those there before as a, like, preemptive measure? Or was he, because if I were one of the, you know, the sergeant or lieutenant in the background, knowing that he was making this stuff up, I'd be kind of thinking, like, huh, is he making this up? That's really interesting. I wonder how much of this is true
sure.
about my boss.
Yeah.
For the playing the prisoner, I had to make a lot of those decisions. We had to make a lot of those decisions of why am I using this tactic? Why is the conversation going this way? And if you look back on it, it's all very close to home for him. So everything is very planned and detailed because he had an abusive father.
Right.
He was in the military. He killed people. He knows what it's like. I keep prodding him. You don't know what it's like, do you? You don't know what it's like, do you? Oh, you do know what it's like. And then it's like, you can trust me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the faith thing. That's the, you know, it's giving him his faith back so that he'll have something to fight for. That's to me, we just kind of had to make those decisions of, this is why I'm talking about my father now, and this is why I'm talking about the military.
One last thing?
Oh, yeah, and I was just going to say, when I was thinking about that as well, it sort of came to me like, it feels like we just have a really sick writer genius as the director. You know, like,
yeah, as
if Kenley can think of all these things, then we just have somebody who has that writing gift who's using it in a really, really sick way.
Absolutely.
Well, not Kenley, the director.
Kenley,
yes.
Kenley,
want to answer that?
What's that?
Well, he never addressed it.
Oh, he never addressed it?
Do you feel like everybody else covered my comment about it?
Well, yes. I think it's very true. We talk about this a lot in lab. You know, how much of these stories actually are drawn from some of his personal truths. And
mm-hmm.
and if you would see it in production, I think a lot might be shown, especially at the end, with not necessarily the script, but the physicality of the prisoner. He does have the same tics. You know, he's kind of itchy with the worms, perhaps. And there's that moment of reflection at the end that was added in that I think does betray some of his emotional toll that this has taken on him, perhaps more than he would imagine. Anybody in this kind of role, yes, he's playing off everything that the chaplain gives him, but the easiest thing to do with that circumstance might be to go to your own past, maybe divert it here or there, maybe embellish it, but I believe there's a germ of truth in many of the things that he brought up.
Cool. Well, we really appreciate you guys participating in this conversation. Thank you, actors. You did a wonderful job.
I've heard that. I've got. I get that a lot.
Even in real life. No.
You really did a good job.
Thanks, man.
Good to see you.
Oh, hey, how are you doing?
Good.
Good. Good. Well, that's a nice little romp, isn't it?